It's because human beings have a very unfortunate tendency of sticking to ideas once ideas form. So if you propose an idea before you tally all the facts and all the feelings, then ideas have this potential to grow into ideologies, meaning that it's not founded by the real facts or the real feelings, but just by the virtue of you having heard of this idea first. And maybe you like the chocolate in which or the environment in which you have heard of this idea. So by exploring all the facts and all the feelings first, it serves as kind of vaccination or inoculation against ideologies, which are like a virus of the mind. It's the analogy I want to I always use. It's because in the book, so-called Thinking Fast and Slow, the ideas captures our imagination for the first maybe half a minute or 1 minute. But once you actually think about the facts and the feelings other people have about the facts, you engage your slower system. And then with that slower system on that issue, then you become immune to future propaganda that targets your feelings and so on, because you have actually deliberated over it. So that's the design principle behind the ORID, focused conversation method. And so I always use this example because it's an example I think everybody in the world who cares about civic tech understands. We have this entity, which is just a small part of it is a private company. Most of it is a meme, a virus, an app, right? Most of it is an idea that people should be liberated or be part-time drivers or something. And this sharing economy, whatever that is defined, is a very potent kind of mind virus in that people really volunteer to join this fleet or this system. And it defeats all the traditional knowledge we have on representative democracy, because even if a sovereign nation, had a popular vote, a referendum even, that is 60% against Uber, there is very little that the sovereign nation could actually do. I mean, you can put people in jail, you can take all out their office, it doesn't matter, tomorrow the app will still run. It really doesn't matter a bit to Uber. And even if you have the support with 95% of people, as long as just 5% of the drivers still believe, sometimes fanatically, in the Uber system, you will still have Uber running in the street and conducting their business as normal, and perhaps even more lucratively because now there is less competition. So the way that the V-Taiwan or the very much the Etalab discourse system that we use in Taiwan when we're tackling the Uber problem, we analyze how they run their PR, and like for example in New York City and in other places, and we found that it's very, very good at engaging people's immediate feelings to provide a kind of superior elite experience or whatever, and that's mobilize celebrities, for example, to go against the New York City's proposed Uber regulation by having one like Uber Black, Uber X, Uber Pop, or something, and then Uber with the mayor's proposal. But if you dial the app to that point, you see that you wait not 5 minutes, but 50 minutes. And so with manipulations like that, which costs nothing for them, they were able to elicit a lot of celebrity and pressure and so on, so that the mayor has to retract actually the plan. So they were a very different kind of lobbying power than we traditionally face. So, and this is the power structure that we drew using the Manuel Castells' communication power framework. The idea in just a couple of minutes is this. Usually, the national government, who is responsible for Uber policies, adopts this so-called one government, one voice. I don't know whether it makes sense here also.
Yes.
Okay, good. thing, which means that early stage decisions in the ministries are usually not shared to the public, but just to the lobbyists. A fact. In Taiwan, I don't know whether it's true here. And the transport agency, the transport ministry, who is ostensibly responsible for fining Uber, of course, see it as a threat to public safety. But then Uber will always say in all the countries that we encountered that they are actually part of the economy ministry because they're just an auction platform online or something, and the Ministry of Transport should not have the say. And sometimes they find sympathizers in the Ministry of Economy. But for most of the citizens, the actual issues about Uber is actually about insurance and taxation. And insurance and taxation are the domain of the Ministry of Finance, who will actually have some reports, but they don't actually have the same exposure as the Occupy, the protest around the Ministry of Transport and the Ministry of Economy. And so in the Taiwan national government around that time, for about a year, the three different ministries all have very different takes, very different ideas of how to deal with Uber or how what Uber really is. But because of the one government, one voice culture, before they come to a consensus, they dare not actually make any public statement. So from the view of the civil society, it's as if the government is not doing anything. But they are actually doing a lot of things. They're just infighting, but they're not actually visible from the outside. Now, so when we talk about this power structure, we say it is only possible to solve the Uber problem if we can get 100% of drivers in the Taipei City to understand fully the facts and the feelings that everybody has around Uber. Because that is the only leverage we have to get Uber to fly to Taiwan and join in a negotiation with us as equals, not as lobbyists or not as protesters. Because if all the drivers see Uber in a different light, then they lost the only thing that matters to them, which is the local participation of independent drivers. Right. So how do we reach the drivers? Now there are all sorts of drivers, right? There's the private sector, which are the taxi fleets, the commercial taxi fleets, which the Ministry of Economy have links to. But they also have some independent drivers who may join or leave a fleet at a time. In Taiwan, a driver can only join one single fleet. So they have this bi-directional relationship, but the independent drivers are not organized, which is why it's dotted. But on the other side, we have the local government's transport people who have contact with both the legal ride-sharing carpooling community, and there are many communities in Taipei where people just drive to work and carry people and maybe charge them a little bit for it, and that's perfectly legal because it's a community and there's no platform doing the arbitration. But there's also the illegal kind of carpooling, or what we call black taxi, or some kind of things like that. And these people are not fined by the Ministry of Transport like Uber did, but they're actually operating very similarly to Uber, just with lower fanfare and without an app. So there's those drivers too, and the local government people and the local civil society around not just taxi drivers, but truck drivers and bus drivers and all the drivers, the unions have the contact with those people. So when we say we want to reach all the drivers in Taiwan, we actually mean all the five private and civil society sectors show here in the graph. Now, so the way we set up this deliberation is to find mediators who are trusted not by the entire government, but just by one single ministry, and trusted by either the union or the taxi fleet also. And we ask these three mediators to lead a survey, and the survey team consists of one representative from elected official ministry, the Minister Jacqueline Tsai's representative, one unelected public servant, like professional public servant, but not working any of the three ministries, so somewhat neutral, and then two people from the GovZero, who are the civic tech community, and two, yes. The first one is from a elected official's office that provides the top power to get the ministries to talk, right? But the actual details is gathered from the professional public servant, and two people from GovZero, the civic tech community, the free software community, and then two people from the Institute of Information Industries representing the stakes of the private sector, the commercial sector, the entrepreneurship, and things like that. So the point with this six-person interview team is that when we are asking those stakeholders in the government and also in the civil society and the private sector, we ask them just three questions. First, if there is one statement you can make on your position to the drivers, what would that be if there's just one? And if there is just one question you would like to ask of the drivers, what would that be? And again, one imaginary future of the Uber issue or the Uber challenge, what would that be? So the present and then the present on the other side and the future that's probably a synthesis of these two positions. And when we're asking those three questions, I discovered that unless we have this kind of cross-sectoral interview team, the dynamic will be different, because then the stakeholders would see that maybe there's no person on their side. And then it would become like a negotiation or like a lobbying or like a protesting, which they have plenty of experience of how to speak to. But with this kind of team, they start to speak more authentically of what their actual concerns are and so on, because there's bound to be two people, at least in the team, who are sympathetic, who could actually understand their view of this issue. And it's also very important that for those six people to be constantly in contact on Slack or on some other communication channels. So this is the link that we have between all the mediators. And once we gathered this data, we set up this polis system. In the polis system, we already know that the Taiwan population wants to talk about Uber, because we did a poll after our first rounds of e-consultation. And everybody wanted to talk about Uber, and then Airbnb, and then Bitcoin. That was the top three. And so we said we talk about Uber, but we use this John Rawls idea of overlapping consensus, meaning that we don't talk about ideologies. We talk about these five simple words, which translates roughly as a non-professional licensed driving their car, carrying passengers who are strangers in the backseat and charging them for it. Okay, so it is a practice, and the practice is very specific. It's narrow enough that it overlaps with all the stakes that the stakeholder groups has shown in the previous slide. And it's specific enough that even people with different ideologies could still manage to agree on this practice, which is why we don't talk about the sharing economy or, you know, larger ideas like that. And then we say, 4 weeks from now, we will hold a deliberation. The deliberation will be 2 hours. We have applied sufficient political pressure on Uber, so Uber will actually join. And then all the leading persons will also join. And then for the 2 hours, our agenda, the things we talk about, and only those things, will be decided, crowdsourced, by the polis system. So it puts a burden on the netizens to set the agenda of the ministerial negotiations, the multi-stakeholder negotiation. What we discovered is that it increased the quality of opinion immensely. Because when we're saying that your idea will become part of our agenda, it conveys, okay, we're also listening to you. But when we're saying our agenda is entirely driven by your opinion, that makes them basically the agenda setting people, and that is the highest ladder in the civic participation ladder, right? So when people are imbued with this kind of power, we see them behaving more civilly and giving much better quality opinions. Now, so we guarantee a deliberation using that as an agenda, and with every step the open data. Now, we crowdsource the facts and work with the Wikipedia community. That's the easy part. The feeling part is handled by polis. And in Mandarin, 我觉得 is both I feel and I think. It's a very polite way of saying I think something. So the feeling could be more personal, which makes it a weak consensus if people agree. Or it could be a little bit more practical, which makes a strong consensus if people agree. So without further ado, This is the link that we sent via the stakeholder groups so that all the drivers in the association or in the fleets or in Uber and Uber Black and Uber X receive this with their SMS or what Facebook or whatever or Twitter on the same hour of the same day. And it is also important because people would see that there's many four different groups online already, not just people speaking from one particular stakeholder group. And so, because they're drivers, I mean, we cannot imagine a driver stop at a red light after receiving the text message and pull up a laptop. It's impossible, right? So it has to work on the mobile phone and on the attention span of maybe 5 seconds to 10 seconds at most. And so with the 10 seconds, and we say no voting while driving. And within those 10 seconds, what they're going to see is just one simple, very simple feeling. And the feeling is about, I don't know, passenger insurance is important or whatever. And then they just say, I agree or I disagree. And when they click, I agree or I disagree, they see their avatar start to move among the groups. Now, police system shows by default celebrities, like people with the most followers or the friends followers on Facebook. So they could at least see where they are among the more famous people online. But if they log in, and many of people log in to show the loyalty, to show the allegiance to the fleet or to the Facebook page that recruited them into this system, right? But once they log in, they see their Facebook friends and their people they follow on Twitter instead of the celebrities. And they will discover, much to their surprise, that their Facebook and Twitter friends are in all the four different groups. So they're not actually enemies, they're friends. It's just they never really talk about this over dinner. So it's a psychological trick that we show to let people see that people have different opinions, that's okay, they're still your friends. And the system also determine based on the yes and no vote, the primary divisive factor using that as the x-axis, and the secondary factor using that as the y-axis. So it's what we call dimensional reduction that you can use in two dimensions very easy at a glance. What kind of groups are there? And so basically the idea is very simple. People, as they propose more moderate ideas after answering the first nine set up by the stakeholders, they will shift in their position and move maybe to the middle. And maybe we see those suggestions as like throwing stones into a pond. It will ripple through people with similar ideas and maybe act like the gravity well or something that pulls them together. Of course, the idea is finally we will have something that is broad enough that reach everybody. And of course, at every step of the way, we export this data, which you can run a generalized linear regression or whatever on it to find why people vote that way. So initially, there's four groups of people: the Uber drivers, taxi drivers, Uber passengers, other passengers. And by the end of first week, they convince each other enough that they form two roughly similar-sized groups. And the first group says Uber is criminal. The Taipei City should already cancel it. And we shouldn't even have this deliberation. And the second group says, even though there's a lot of taxi on the street, I will still call it Uber. So these are very personal feelings, right? But we say in the beginning that our agenda is to be done by the global consensus of all the drivers that's higher than 80%. Okay, that's our threshold. So if you multiply the numbers, group one has about half of the population. Three-fourths of it believes in this feeling. If you multiply this is in the very low 20s or low 30s, both of these sentiments, which means they're not good enough, right? From 30% to 80%, that's a very, very long way to go. So none of these feelings will be included in the agenda, okay? And because of the system prioritize the higher consensus items, both within the group and also globally, by the end of first week, people start to compete for in-group recognition. There's no global consensus at that point. So at the beginning of the second week, we see more moderate feelings that are refinements of the first week opinions. This one says the Ministry of Transport should fine all the illegal taxis. Maybe they were too focused on Uber, but it is still their job. Okay, so it's more moderate. It wins more approval. And the second group refines it, saying, currently Taiwan, a taxi driver can only join one fleet, and the fleet assigned them a lot of extra work, like moving houses or tourism or whatever, in order to earn more money in addition to the taxi meter. Okay, and that lowers the labor union's bargaining power. But with Uber, a driver can join Uber and Lyft and Sidecar and Didi Dache and whatever, right? And so now, because of this freedom, it actually strengthens the labor union, because then they can argue for better conditions, and they could quit if Uber is not as competitive as other platforms. Now, it's a pretty good argument, actually. But still, it is in not even 50, majority-wise. So again, it's not good enough, because we require 80%. And of course, nobody in group one agreed with this sentiment. It is very divisive, right? But this sentiment is also notable, because the day it was proposed, we see the group two gain 2% of people, mostly independent taxi drivers. So it's actually quite useful in the kind of lobbying way to attract more people to join the group. So on the third week, beginning of third week, we finally start to see global consensus. Now, there's thousands of people participating, but because by now there's 30 sentiments already, most people don't vote through all the 30 sentiments, so it becomes a kind of sampling. So it will say at that point, of the 400-something people who saw it, most of the people agreed, but not all drivers saw this sentiment. So the sentiment is basically saying the law should change with the development of technology. Yeah, the sky is blue, water is wet, why not? but still, it has to have something to do with the deliberation, and it does, right? So it is a legal sentiment, it's an okay sentiment that everyone managed to agree. But what this does, though, is that it proves, it's an existential proof, that people who were so polarized still managed to agree on something. And the number 90% means something for the East Asian, Japan, Taiwan, China culture, because it's what it's like here in the A grade. This is a good grade for a student. Okay, so now people, once they get the grade of A, they try to compete to get A+, right? So then people spend a week trying to come up with a sentiment that will convince even more people than 91%, because now they're included in the agenda now. So now, this is, again, a very well-balanced, not really saying much. Drivers are important, examination is important, passenger ride is important, whatever, but the security is the most important. Yeah, who would disagree? This is, but it is, again, a little bit more practical, and everybody managed to agree. And of these general sentiments, the winner, and we celebrate the highest score, is Ivan, who is a Firefox developer in Taiwan, a Mozilla developer. He's not even into transport or anything. And so he offers a very outsider perspective. He says, what Uber is basically just an algorithm for the driver to rate 5 stars, the passenger and the passenger to rate 5 stars of the drivers. So if you just subsidize the construction of the system and make it freely available to all the taxi fleets in Taiwan and all the independent drivers, then Uber will lose its edge, right? And then everybody in Taiwan will get better quality taxis, because now the government pays the fleet to build such a system that Uber uses. It is a very engineering kind of sentiment. But then the Uber mediators in their group say, okay, if this becomes the law, Uber becomes the first legal taxi fleet in Taiwan, right? Because they have the system, and the other taxi will take time to build such a system. So it's a win-win solution, and then everybody managed to agree. Now, people see that it's possible to come up with what we call innovation, innovative solutions that convince everybody. This sentiment below, which says basically we don't negotiate with criminals, had actually pretty high support 45% at the beginning of the deliberation. But by the time Ivan came up with this, we see a sharp drop, a 10% drop. Now that people see it's possible to reach consensus, people start to think, okay, even though they're criminals, we still sit down and talk with them. And the ratio keeps dropping by the fourth week. So by the fourth week, we have six suggestions ordered here from weak to strong that are all more than 80% consensus. And none of them are 95%, of course, because that was very general. But this is something more practical. This could be turned into law immediately. So the weakest one saying, whatever law we pass should be fair with the existing legal or illegal drivers and Uber. It should not be about Uber. Uber should set up a local taxation with the local city government. And now when they satisfy, and this is sequential, I mean, they have to first do this and then do this and then do this. They must display prominently on the windshield a U or something that shows they're a Uber car. And when the driver goes into the car, they must see a registration certificate that certifies the person driving is actually the person you're calling. And then once they do that, we say that still it's worth it to regulate them more strictly because like medicine and like food, it is a matter of public safety. So even though it's an economic affair, we still warrant a more strict regulation. And one of the strict regulations that we have consensus is that if people want to avoid paying taxes, if people say it's just a carpooling platform, one should register just one commute to my office in the morning and maybe another trip back home. And on those two trips, I can carry any number of passengers and charge them for it. It shouldn't be a problem. It should not be taxation. I should not set up a professional license for it. And I can use Uber to do it. People say it's okay. But if people commute 50 times a day and then carry 70 passengers, obviously, they're not carpooling. And once people start doing that, then they better get registration and get commercial insurance and everything that has the same regulation as taxi drivers. And finally, if the government and all the stakeholders agree on this, then all the taxi drivers want the right to join Uber. And all the Uber drivers want the right to join taxi fleets. Okay, so it becomes a plural relationship between the drivers and the fleets. So as you could see, there is a logical sequence to those six consensus. And even though it's from weak to strong, the strong builds on the consensus already made by the weak consensus. And so it's not too bad. So with those six police consensus, we did a comparative study. Aside from the countries who does not yet have the resolution, some countries had, right? So we say, of those six consensus, there are actually very similar passages in those international regulations. So if we can get all the stakeholders to agree on those six consensus and the three sentiments, maybe tomorrow we can have a regulation by copy and pasting the relevant chapters in those international law systems. And then we sat down and we had a deliberation. And the Ministry of Transport, the Economy, Finance came, the Minister came, this ex-Googler expert. We have the fleets, Taiwan Taxi, the other commercial fleets, and again, all the presidents and CEOs. And we have the head of the Independent Drivers Association in Taipei. And this is Uber Asia's PR. This is Uber Taiwan CEO and their lawyer. So basically everybody who has a stake join us in this kind of a round table. And they know that they're being filmed. And they know that every word they say is being typed by a stenographer to that's listed alongside the live stream. This is what we call sunflower technology. And so in this kind of environment, we already know that people will behave like adults. Because it doesn't pay to behave like children when you know that thousands of drivers are watching every word you say and they're going down to history in transcripts. So so we start working on those consensus. And so a typical negotiation looks like, okay, so now the screen displays the consensus about insurance. And then the Uber CEO says, okay, we do have international insurance. We will help them to make claims if they have damages. And the facilitator, which is me, would ask, okay, so how many claims has happened before in the past year? And then the CEO would say it has never happened before. And then the ex-Google engineer would ask, this is very simple, right? What is your insurance policy terms? Can you show it to the minister? And to do the passenger, if there's a accident, have to fly to Ireland or to, I don't know, Seattle to claim the damage. And the independent association driver said, I actually talked with the CEO about this. They don't have it printed within. But the lawyer says, we will provide insurance terms right after the deliberation to the minister's office, who can then decide whether to publish or not. So that's one consensus item. And then the other one is me asking the Minister of Transport, saying, okay, so people don't want you to be unfair to Uber and other illegal operations in Taiwan, but you issued a ruling saying Uber is illegal without mentioning any other illegal operations. So what did you do? I mean, did you actually compare the two different cases or do case study or focus group, or did you just did a legalistic interpretation? And the ministry representatives say, we just did a legalistic interpretation. We didn't actually talk to anybody. So we are open to revision. So that's another consensus item. And then the commercial fleet says, actually, we want to compete on surge pricing. We want to compete on limousine Uber Black service. It's just the current taxi meter law restricts us. So all the arguments the consensus people have about the exploitation of drivers is because the government doesn't allow a higher class of taxis with better cars and with better meters. If the Minister of Transport could allow this, then we welcome Uber. We will be competing on very similar stance. And much to our surprise, in this kind of perhaps because they know thousands of drivers are watching, the Ministry of Transport people say, okay, we will open a higher end of taxi service and change the metering rules, and we will start the research on that now, which is not bad as far as consensus goes. So they're really just speaking to the constituency, really, much like the police dynamic. And now, by that time, the independent driver association says, okay, then we're willing to join Uber, of course, but they take a 20% cut. And now we cannot make a living with this kind of cut. If they reduce it to 2%, we can do the collaboration as the consensus, the sixth consensus item, talk about. So if it becomes a business negotiation at a time. But on taxation, Minister Jacqueline Tsai said, the problem of this is that Uber say they report all the taxes and so on, but it is not transparent because it's not even a Taiwan company. We cannot do independent auditing. So if they say there are this amount of dollars that was collected this month, there's no way for us to know whether it's true or not without having a partnership with, I don't know, Dublin government or Seattle government or San Francisco government, which will probably never do a special relationship with Taiwan government for the auditing. So Jacqueline says, for the consensus I have about reporting tax to the local city government, it probably requires Uber to set up a local office just for the purpose of reporting of taxes and collecting the payments. And at that point, something interesting happened. Uber Asia's PR, Vicky Zheng, deflected this question, saying, instead of taxes, we can provide something better. We can provide real-time smart traffic information for the city grid, so that any city government who partner with Uber gets a upgrade on their infrastructure. And with our big data analytics possibilities, we can identify the hotspots in the parking and whatever. Okay, and then we have that partnership with Philippines, and Taiwan does not want to lose on the modernization of their transportation infrastructure, right? So the good thing about POLIS and the structure that we use it is that at that point, I'm able to say, but we agreed to only talk about drivers' consensus, okay? So whatever case you want to make with the city governments, you can go ahead and make it to the city government, but this, we say, we respect the drivers' consensus and talk only about it. So please respond to the consensus. And that worked. I mean, otherwise we will have a completely different communication. And so So all the drivers saw that Uber actually agreed on five of the six, or 4.5 of the six consensus items. The Ministry of Transport agreed on all of it. The commercial fleet drivers agreed on all of it, but with the reservation of surge pricing. And the Independent Association of Drivers agreed on everything except for the royalty, and so on. So people see very clearly where everybody stands. And now it's up to Uber to say, okay, whether they want to register a local office for collecting tax and make transparent their income. And because they're not yet doing it, the Ministry of Transport keeps fining it. But when they do it now, they are not afraid of being surrounded by angry drivers anymore. And again, when Uber maybe someday agree to work with the local government in the way that the consensus item delineated, people would then welcome them without saying that they're criminals or things like that. So it's that people just behave like adults when at the end of a deliberative process like that. And the other good thing about this is that it enables us, the V Taiwan team, to become kind of a sector here between the private and the civic sector. In theory, I usually say this is a mediation sector, but among my more geeky engineer friends, I usually say this is the boot sector, the bootstrapping sector, because so for the non-geeky friends here, a bootstrapping sector is a very special place in your hard disk or in your computer that translates all the data on the hard disk into instructions for the CPU. Without the boot sector, none of those specialized data would make sense to the processing unit. So it is a sector of translation that makes it possible for people speaking different language to start to speak each other. So now that we have this kind of position in the Taiwan society, we are then able to work with internal mediators that then collect early stage opinions. And this is actually the solution to the one government, one voice problem. Because in Taiwan, we have this culture of civic servants being very afraid of speaking out, because unlike the UK, they're not totally anonymous. So if they do something wrong, they do get blamed by mainstream media. But if they do something right, the elected officials, the ministries, the president, the mayors get all the praise. And by the mainstream media, and then they become anonymous. So with this kind of reward structure, of course, nobody wants to do anything because there's everything to lose and nothing to gain. But with the I don't know whether this is the same in France, but in Taiwan it's a big problem. Totally different. France doesn't have this problem. Okay. I'll skip the slide then. In any case, in any case, what this enables then is we get a lot of volunteers who joins the GovZero community, our monthly hackathon, everything, while keeping their position as professional public servants. Because then they see that it is a flipping the default, so to speak. Because whatever agenda setting, whatever deliberation they enact through GovZero becomes very well reported by the media and so on. And their boss, the elected officials, have to actually follow their very expert, I'm sure, analysis on this matter. And if they do something wrong, they could always say GovZero is just civil society, it does experiments, it fails all the time, why not? So it becomes a very innovative for them to just propose whatever their idea has and prototype it in GovZero. So, for example, we have the Environment Agency people working with GovZero to build env.govzero.tw. Or the legislative yuan people building ly.govzerov.tw. Now, all the GovZero projects have the right to use this domain name in Taiwan. And this is just one letter, well, one stroke, different from their official websites. So the environmental agency in Taiwan is actually envgov.tw. So people always know where to find the shadow government. it just requires you to first find the ministry or the actual government site and change the O to a zero, and then you get into this linked data, fully visualized, forecast on GitHub version of the same ministry functions or part of the ministry functions. And once these are prototyped good enough and get mainstream attention or all the drivers or the constituency attention, then it would just so happen that people would want the government to merge it back to their official website. And because we relinquish our copyright, it is very hard for the government to say no. So they do actually merge back to their websites. So it is a way where we call fork the government. We try to prototype, often with help of public servants, and prototype for the government. And once something works, they merge back to it. And so with this kind of empowered space, when we do things like Airbnb, and Airbnb already know how we've done with Uber, so they work with Wikipedia community to provide all the facts and join the police and set up all the three different groups. And in fact, actually sent a email to every Airbnb user in Taiwan, says go on VTaiwan and vote for us. And so we see that initially the participation number is like this, but after Airbnb sent that email, is like this. But much to Airbnb's surprise also, not all their users are happy with them. So there are actually three groups of varying, and only about one third fully supports the Airbnb position. But we managed to have pretty good consensus out of it. And the main contention being, there's a lot of people who want to be Airbnb landlords, but not a lot of people who want to be Airbnb tenants in Taiwan because they don't have the insurance protection. Okay, so it's asymmetrical. So, but the reflections are generally positive. And again, we did a comparison study. And then Airbnb flew. This is Airbnb Korea, Airbnb Hong Kong, Airbnb legal people. Their co-founder also flew to Taiwan. And when we did this with the hotel association, the tourism bureau, or the public officials here, what happens is that when we show a consensus on the screen, an Airbnb representative would say, yeah, we did our homework, we agree. We will have a insurance policy internationally, and Taiwan will be our first experimental site. And then when the next consensus appears, they will say, okay, we will work with the law enforcement and make sure that there's no one person with 10 houses with identical photo, so, and things like that. And so yeah, for all the consensus items, there's 7 of them, and Airbnb just said, we agree. We thought about it. We agree. We know you're going to do this, so we agree. And so there's really no problem with legalization. And of course, we copy and pasted a lot from the French Airbnb laws that has the pertaining to that consensus. So I mean, this is a large operation involving a lot of people in the civil society, in the private sector, also in the ministries. But I think it's because it's dealing with something that's what we call an innovation subject, Uber and Airbnb. It's a future that's not tied to any particular place. It's not constructing an airport in Nantes, right? Or in Taoyuan or in Tuscany. And so it's not a development case or an ecological case. It's a innovation case. And for a case like that, I think any consensus people reach in Paris could be used in Taiwan also. And again, the consensus people reach in Taiwan about Uber is equally applicable in Paris or Brussels or anywhere. And that's the beauty of this kind of cases. Now, I have other plans to work on the airport case and other case with virtual reality, but that's a topic for another day. So about police, this is how we use police. Any questions, thoughts, ideas, feelings?
The example you gave were based on global, let's say, corporations that changed the game in the global space. So, have you used the same methods for much more local issues?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. Yes, so our new president-elect, Dr. Tsai Ing-wen, she says her main platform was that there's a balance between the ecology or ecosystem, the development, and innovation, right? And it is true that so far this methodology works best with the third part of concern. But with development, there is one case in Tainan City. Tainan is a very green, very beautiful, culturally pleasant city. I haven't been to Nantes. But the Tainan City has this development case called Feiyan Xinchun of the Feiyan Village. And it is a small village that's kind of abandoned because the ownership was not clear and it was a sore spot in city planning. And of course this FAR group, FAR Eastern group? FAR Glory group, won the bid from the Ministry of Military of Defense, who was the owner of that land, and did a very good planning, I guess, with a lot of high buildings and a mall and some kindergarten, I don't know, but something that makes it very modern. And and people protest around it because they think that when you have in the middle of nowhere this kind of a park, really, that is also a industrial complex, is very Taipei style. And in that case, it will gentrify the neighborhood in a matter of months, if not days, right? And then there's also ecological concerns of all the old trees in that arena, and there's also the concern of a lot of archaeological sites that was just uncovered a month or so before the planned construction, and people debate over whether it's important or not. I mean, it's not the oldest archaeological site; it's not kind of the treasure of archaeology, but it still is a archaeological finding. So, how much concern should we have, right? So, we used more or less the same method, but we used the what's the French word? The worldwide views method that the French people work with the Danish people, I think, for the COP21. The methodology is very simple. Worldwide views is it ends with 108 people sitting in various tables debating the various aspects of this development, but they were informed by three videos. So instead of one Wikipedia timeline and one slide show per stakeholder, like what I did with Uber, they see three 15-minute video, and taken by the public sector and the private sector, which represent the development company, and the civil society, which represent the ecological and archaeological needs. And they took 11 preparatory meetings to get all the stakeholders agree on the factualness of their respective presentation. And then they do this one-day deliberation day, and by the end of the day, they also suggest those write-in suggestions that citizens have in addition to the agenda setting that the three stakeholders propose in the beginning as the initial seed questions. So the same methodology as we did with POLIS. But I think that case is fortunate because it is very small sites. The actual people living in the immediate vicinity is around 300 people. So we don't actually have to do sortition, because when you count the people who actually have the time to attend, it's roughly 100 people. So again, like what we could say, all the drivers in Taipei have heard of it and could participate. We could also say everybody nearing Feiyan Xinchun have heard of it and could participate. So, but for something like an airport, which is between the size of these two ends, and between the development and innovation spectrum of these two ends, we don't have a success case yet, but we're working on it. Yeah. Other reflections, thoughts?
How much time does it take to conduct the entire process?
Almost half a year. Yeah, it's usual, yeah. yeah. I mean, from the initial survey and the initial buy-in to the actual follow-up, it would take, yeah, usually. But the user visible, though, is usually just 3 months. It's the second half, right? So, for example, for the law change, we did a lot of law change using this method, actually. This is, actually, you probably know all these issues. It's what everybody is talking about, is the interface between the internet and the sovereign nations, right? So for laws like these, a usual user visible schedule would look like something like this. So for a limited participation, closely held corporation, we will have the initial discussion and on discourse, just like you. And on discourse, we use the discourse functionality called mark as with administration power, meaning that sentence is marked with a yellow background. And on the interface, it looks like a shield. And when you click the shield, it's marked as yellow. But we use that function as saying, this will be included in the agenda of deliberation. So people compete also for that, like making constructive suggestions.
And who marks
the six-person team, the cross-sectoral team who did the original survey, and also the site maintenance. I mean, if you go to our website, you've got to trust us already. So, and because it's cross-sectoral, we get to kind of balance each other's views. So if one admin is abusing their power, they know they're going to be watched by the other sector's admins. So we don't really have abusing admins that way. And so of all these issues, maybe 23rd of them will be marked as agenda worthy. And then this will be done with Sunflower technology, with all the stakeholders sitting down, roundtable, 2 hours, live script, everything. And then talking with just these items and forming their expert opinion, legal scholars from the UK, US tradition and of the civil tradition, continental tradition will debate whether it is a breakage to have a company that awards stocks based on reputation, for example. I don't know whether you have a problem like this in France. You don't? It's not a French problem. Okay, so in Taiwan, who inherit the German law system, it is a lot of troubles for us to start to accept Silicon Valley or Cayman Island style companies. So the balance has to be found. And then after that, this is when I was talking a couple of days ago with Camille Francois, she said that this is a I think that the only innovative process in that we took a page from the Internet Society, from IETF. Usually, this consultation will produce a report in other countries that is then sent to the government. But we introduce an additional step called the working group. And the working group is anyone who have made constructive constructions, discussions, either before the consultation or after the consultation online. They all get an invitation letter that says, if you show up at this place, a very warm, cozy place in Taipei, or if you dial in online, then you get to participate in the working group. And what we're doing in the working group is that we know we're not lawyers, so we're not writing code, writing legal code. And what we're doing, though, is that we're building a request for comment. And a request for comment is a very humble way of saying that if the Taiwan want a new kind of company that is more like the Cayman Island or Silicon Valley company, it must allow multiple votes per share. It must not restrict crowdfunding platform participation. It should allow online like chair board meetings. It should not. It may not. So this language is what the Internet Society uses to write the laws of the Internet. And because we say it's just a request for recommendation, for comments, it also means that we don't have to use precise legalese. And also means that we don't need to have fine consensus. It's okay to have a rough consensus. And if it's rough, we just say may. If it's like roughly okay, we say should. Only when it's very strong, we say must. And again, this is all from the Internet Society. But the beauty of this kind of document is that it changed the relationship between the working group, the civil society, and the ministry. Because then the ministry are not agenda setters. They're implementers. They're like the programmers who look at a RFC and try to code a system based on it. They become implementers. And so with this analogy, what they are doing is that they're coding legalese to satisfy the recommendation that the working group pushes forward. But the working group is kind of illiterate in code, as some working groups in IETF are. And it's up to the coders to tell it's not physically possible, or that it is outside the jurisdiction, or something. But for things that are actually feasible, they are required to code the law so that it corresponds exactly to the sentence. And we also use Gitbook to do the version management. So all the Gitbook become automatically discourse topics. There's a bidirectional synchronization so that people can all follow up not on the issue tracking system, but just on discourse, which are then expanded into the Gitbook view. So what the effect is that when the law was drafted by the ministry and published on VTaiwan, for each paragraph in the law, there's one corresponding line of justification that links back to the RFC. And then on the RFC, there is one for each recommendation, the link back to the transcript of the working group meeting where this consensus was formed. And that has the backlink to the initial discussion of who actually proposed this idea in the first month. So this entire process basically becomes an audit trail for the entire society to see why the law is written in this way. And then when it was passed to the assembly, that session ends in June the 3rd. And because the DPP was proposing a constitutional change, they were filibustering each other and not passing any laws. But for this law, they had to pass. So they passed just this law at the end of the session. Because the two parties, or three or four, depending on how you count, but the two major parties all have people invested already in this process. And unless they discover more facts or more feelings than the working group already did, there really is no way for them to say no to the already established social consensus. And so they had to pass, otherwise they're the, I don't know, enemy of the state or something, of the existing consensus. So to go into a little bit more technical detail, and I'll open the floor. Again, yes?
One question again on the working group. Where are the people in the working group selected? It's the topics that were marked
and then
so you suggest those people.
And then get a invitation, and they could attend in person.
So
or,
physical meetings.
Yeah, of course. IETF always begin with physical meetings. Email is just follow up.
Mm.
Right, that's the core philosophy, right? And the idea is that they should have sufficient representation. So again, I mean, this one is about MOOC, which is the massive online courses. And this is the slide that we use to summarize the discourse discussion. We separate it into one fact about this agenda. About this fact, there are two feelings. And about these two feelings, there are two ideas, one idea respectively for each feeling. And we use a font with six different weight to represent different strengths of consensus. So we can see, everybody can see at a glance that there are two feelings, and this already has very strong consensus online. We have to only hum to make it pass. And the other ones may need more deliberation. And for people who cannot attend the offline meeting, we set up a high-quality omnidirectional telepresence system so people can see it maybe with a VR helmet, but mostly in the front of the screen and in their home. And there is, so I was the offline facilitator, but Jiahua was the online facilitator who then collects everything that they type while the offline group was debating this particular aspect. And then so after 20 minutes of humming and debating on this topic, we switch the view to the collected hackpad of the online portion, And if the online portion also generally hum to agree, well, they cannot really hum, but they could use cat smileys to to express agreement. And then we say, okay, this is good enough. Or if they uncover something that the offline group had not yet deliberated, then we enter a second round on the spot until we have general consensus between the online and offline portions. The idea is that we give the same airtime between the offline space and the online space in a working group meeting like that, so that I hope I answered your question. Yeah. Lots of ideas? Yeah.
Maybe one more question.
Yeah, sure.
About the interface between civil society and government.
Mm-hmm.
You paint quite a rosy picture
mm-hmm.
of how it works
exactly.
in Taiwan.
Yes.
I guess it has maybe not always been that easy. You
uh-huh.
probably encountered some roadblocks,
mm-hmm.
kind of immune reaction
mm-hmm.
from the government.
Oh, yeah.
At the beginning, could you tell us
focus
more
on the less rosy parts?
How
okay.
How you overcame it?
Sure.
What
yes.
you could learn from it?
That is a great question. Well, then we have to go all the way back to, I don't know, how much back. Okay, so I'll give a very, very TLDR version of Taiwan's history. Taiwan currently don't have our own constitution. We use a adapted kind of unikernel fragment of the original China constitution, right? And we're not a United Nations nation, and so we're a place with, like the Vatican, I guess, with 23 million people of a civil society. So it's a very large civil society, international law speaking. And it has always kind of been that way. When Japan colonized Taiwan, and that was after the Qing dynasty, and then that was after the Dutch people, right? So the Dutch people, the Qing people, and the Japanese. And the Japanese brought to Taiwan a very modern kind of public servant system, and in which they modeled themselves after the UK system. So there is a proud tradition of professional public servants in Taiwan that goes on for many years. When the Kuomintang, after losing the Civil War, and came to Taiwan, they did not actually change the public servant structure. What they did, though, is that they imposed a martial law on that island that restricts the freedom of speech, of media, of assembly, and have a personal worship of Chiang Kai-shek. Chiang Kai-shek died the same year as Franco in Spain, and similar dynamics. And then we have the democratization. And the democratization began, widely speaking, around 89, and mostly out of the desire not to repeat the mistake Beijing did to their students. And that's where it began. And it's generally considered complete, the democratization, in 96, in which we had the first presidential election. Okay, so that's the TLDR of Taiwan's so the important thing here is that the first generation who could assembly and make free speech is the same generation growing up with personal computers. And the same generation who could do campaigning online is the same generation who could do campaigning offline. Right? So it's the same generation. So whereas in countries with hundreds of years of 5 layers of Republican tradition. It is, of course, different for people to go on the internet, which is cool, and you can meet strangers, versus going to political work, where, like, learning classical Chinese, you have to spend, I don't know, decades to get better at it and to quote, learn all the important quotes. But in Taiwan, because all of this is in flux, so for us, the direct e-democracy system and the representative democracy system had the same starting line. And so it's very natural for us to mix and match the different democratic methods because they all start in the same year. Okay, that's the cultural background. You see some of that with Podemos and with Estonia also. Yeah, there's no legacy. Yes.
We have a bit more.
Yes, but then we do also have the legacy starting from Japan, which is the public servant structure. It was preserved regardless of how democratic the country is, the proud culture of professional public servants. And usually the ministers, and like Minister Jacqueline Tsai said, it's almost as if they were speaking a different language, a language that's hundreds of years old. And until I speak that language, you cannot even turn a gear in this machine. So I feel like that I have to learn baby talk again when she joined the ministry. From IBM, she was the head of IBM Asia's law department. So it's not that, and she was a judge before that. So she actually speaks legalese very well, but not this brand of legalese. So this culture, which I refer fondly as the paper culture, with all due respect, thank you. With all due respect, the TLDR of all the pushbacks are the resistance or the cultural imbalance stem from this clash of civilizations, of the paper civilization and the numeric civilization. And the way I usually talk about this is this. So paper was invented 2,000 years ago, and it's a good media. I mean, it preserves the durableness of bamboo and easy to copy as papyrus. And the entire Taiwan culture about public servant is taken from Japan, which was then taken from the Tang Dynasty public servant system. And that dynasty's Tang system is very interesting because it makes full use of a new calligraphic style. It used to be, when paper was first invented, everybody wrote in this style called Li Shu. And and which translates roughly as slave script. Okay. And the thing of this style is that it's very deliberate. It takes a long time to write. It's almost like carving, and then but it's impossible to get wrong when you copy it for 10 or 1,000 copies for all the officials, and it removes personality from writing. But the thing about Tang Dynasty is that it makes full use of the art inspired form of writing called Xingshu, so called the walking script. And the thing of walking script is that it's supposedly the writer writes the same speed as they're thinking. So even if they're writing the same sentence, the same Confucian classical quotes, perhaps, the reader can know what they actually feel about the sentence that they're writing. It has two very good properties that makes it a standard script for people to write to the emperors or the public officials or the mayors. First, it preserves the nonverbal information of what's going on in the head, the emotional state of the writer. And second, it demands roughly the same attention span as the reader from the writer, because the writing was balanced in that it's not entirely unrecognizable, but it takes some effort to go into reading it. So it is what I call the symmetry of attention. The entire Taiwan public servant structure was built with this kind of calligraphic style. They resist very firmly the use of what we call the Gothic or the Korean New or you know, these kind of fonts. They insist on using the fonts that are calligraphic in their online presentations, which by the way, it's very hard to read in mobile devices. So that's our first pushback. But when I talked more deeply with the public servants, they're not reacting out of neglect or ignorance, because they too grew up with the personal computer generation. They argue that there is something to be preserved in this culture, because they say on Facebook or on Twitter or on something, it's as if we go back to the era of the slave script. I take an hour to prepare a message, but the person just take 5 seconds to swipe away. I don't really engage the reader the same speed as I write. And then people don't see my full mental state when I write this kind of thing. Even if I do infographic, or even if I do an Instagram or a broadcast or whatever, or a recording like to a TV, the camera always just captures my face. So it prioritizes people who could engage the fastest and the impulsive system of their readers or their viewers. And they think that it is a sacrifice of the paper culture if we migrate to the digital culture. So it is very interesting, because we had actually many philosophical discussions around this topic. And so my conclusion was basically that we have to bring back, which is why I always use pen-based computing, bring back some of those properties, either with virtual reality or with better deliberation design or online or offline telepresence or whatever, and convince the public servants that by doing away with paper, they don't do away with calligraphy and whatever virtue the calligraphy represents in their minds. I understand it's coming from a very different culture, but it makes a critique to the social media and to the social internet also.
Maybe here it's the same with people doing maps. That's why they have been more involved in the paper culture. So that's one of the... No, but I mean, I'm half kidding.
Mm-hmm.
No?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. I haven't built consensus.
It's an idea. Yeah.
I'm sorry because I have another meeting. But
sure.
Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. Rest of the team, but this was very inspiring. Mm-hmm. And thank you. For how long are you still in Paris?
I stay till Friday, but I'll be back in the end of May and also then for the August September.
So, maybe
yeah.
December.
Yeah.
I'll leave Claire-Marie, maybe we have
some. Okay, we can schedule.
Things to discuss with
okay,
you.
Cool.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Another question on the historical part, to elaborate a bit on the question on my right. Okay, so beyond far superior writing and coding abilities and a political system that's very young,
mm-hmm.
which other ingredients would be necessary for such a system to be duplicated? To be a bit more precise, of course, with the successes that you've
mm-hmm.
had,
mm-hmm.
I think it's much easier to engage stakeholders to
mm-hmm.
actually spend the time to
yeah.
make a 15 minutes video and attend 11 meetings.
Yeah.
But how did it start?
Right. So it's a saying that I like to say is that before you get a crowd, the demos, you have to do a demo. and this was our demo. So it starts by occupying the parliament for 20 days and 22 days and winning. Yeah. It starts with the occupy and exporting the technology also. You've probably seen this picture before, okay? It's variously called as the world's politest protesters. And I was in Düsseldorf at that time and projecting my tweets to the Hong Kong wall. And one correspondent in Twitter says, "Wow, the movement's website is the most technological advance I have seen in history." And then one of their Twitter friends said, "But I've seen this website before." And CEO Gao, co-founder of Zero, said, "Yeah, it's the same as the Sunflower Occupy in Taiwan. It just so happened they forked our GitHub repository and took the same technology." So the technology looks like this. It's to the left, a crowdsourced bookmark. And to the right, a directory to the real-time barricades, medical supplies, police, gangsters, all the dynamic forces. If people have played any kind of real-time strategy game, it's that kind of thing. And then also rumors and actual news correlated on the timeline and geotagged. And also 4 or 9 screen real-time video feed, which people can comment and make stenographic contribution transcriptions of what they have heard. And finally, the logistics spreadsheet, which lists for each column, each side of occupy, what kind of people power they need, what kind of supply they need, what kind of they have overflown, and link to the related live video stream. So the good ideas would spread. So this technology was prototyped in Taiwan and perfected during the Sunflower Occupy. Now, I don't have a lot of time to go into the details, but the idea is very simple, is that people who occupy the parliament set up their own broadcasting device, and we, GovZero, who supported them on the streets, on the left and the right of the parliament site, did our own YouTube broadcast using WiMAX. And all of this are transcribed on Hackpad, and then we work with 12 languages translation team to then translate it into their daily updates. And then we use the EtherCalc, which is also used here as FremaCalc, I think, which I maintain, and developed and with Dan Bricklin to do this shared bookmarking so everybody can contribute an additional system by building the system and then just linking to the master directory. And all it was done in the first day. It was very important because it happened in the night. And by the next morning, all the mainstream media initially painted the occupiers as mobsters or as, you know, drunkards or, you know, people, what people usually do when they see things like that. But because we already are broadcasting 24/7 on Ustream and YouTube and with real-time transcripts for 12 hours by that time, most of the citizens don't believe the mainstream media when they read the morning news. Because we have the complete footage of the entire breaking in and negotiating supplies and its nonviolent nature. So for the next 22 days, it becomes the Sunflower technology-powered civic media versus mainstream media. And by the end of the 20 days, the social consensus was the mainstream media has lost and have to change their ways. And one of the example being that we set up a real-time projection screen on the street so that rumors don't spread. And I provided this intranet CAT6 cables, 350 meters, to link the three Occupy sites into an intranet so that you can view the what's really happening in the Occupy site from the street with 20 millisecond delay. And we have a stenographer who can type 400 words per minute in the arena and then type whatever she heard so that people can at a glance tell the rumors from the facts. And fact check also the stenography with the actual live video feed. It's called a transparent wall. And we also have the civic journalists and print. This is self-service print your own journalist badge service. And that links to a constitutional ruling that says for the public information of the national concern, all the journalists that are civic must enjoy the same property of right as mainstream media. It was a Supreme Court ruling that was done a few years ago. So we quote that ruling. So anybody who print this and upload their name and their photo gets printed and stick it to the back of their iPad. And so that we have 20 or so cameras on the field at any time to reduce conflict and violence. And if the police give them troubles, then they ask the police to scan the QR code to read the Supreme Court rulings. This is the actual ruling translated to French. So with a media facility like this, people start to be able to actually deliberate on the cross-strait trade agreement. And then we also provide this informed tool where you can type your company or the trade you have and receive a three-panel comics representing whether the Chinese investment or personnel can come, whether your personnel or investment can come, and citing the WTO and UN, the definitions in its full if you're interested in the details, a neutral deliberation tool. So with that and have a million people on the street, we have a lot of surplus people. And with the surplus people, the cognitive surplus, as Cherky would say, we're then grouped to the three different streets debating the relationship with China and the ecological impact and the labor, the left impact outside the parliament, in which inside they were also doing the same deliberation. And we try to use Lumio and other tools to link the empowerment of those different deliberation consensus up to the level where we extract promise out of the present level intellect to change our constitution, reflecting this kind of consensus. So this is the beginning to answer your question. So to a demo that shows it is possible to have a mediated space in the middle of the private and the civil sector and the government. And within this space, people could really speak authentically. And that was the position we were at the mid-2014. I'm not saying that you should occupy the assembly, by the way.
No, but it shows once again that actual change starts with the major.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, other thoughts, questions?
We still have some more time and no one else has a question. Mm-hmm. I'd be interested in following a bit of the history, like how did the transition from this particular Occupy and the first team, and how do you end up 1 year and a half later with trying to build the future together on smaller scales rather than just trying to prevent something awful on a larger scale to happen? How did you do that?
Yes. So, because it's, I mean, the revolution was televised, so people see with their own eyes that I think the important part is that the independents, the separatists, the left and the green, the ecological people in Taiwan wasn't actually in a very good relationship before the Occupy. There were largely three non-overlapping groups of people, I mean, people would say they're of the broad left. But all of them resist this label. So we see with our own eyes, with the people who goes to the three deliberation sites, act as cross-pollinators. They'll attend one deliberation about ecology, and then take that argument to the one about labors, and take that to the one about sovereignty, and so on. And so after, 10 days, of televised what we call D Street deliberation, the entire civil society sees that maybe not the party leaders, but the people who were their constituencies gradually fuse into one constituency. And this is something that has never happened before in any of the street demonstrations in Taiwan. Because previously we had a lot of large demonstrations, but they were not what we call safe space. Right, there's a lot of conflict, escalation, potential violence. People were not feeling safe enough to sit down and deliberate. But with this kind of technology and with 20 cameras filming all sides and so on, and everything being transcribed, people actually feel safe enough to sit down and have a discussion. And once they do that for 10 days, a different consensus start to form that make coherent those three different concerns. So this, what we call, people usually call it the white power or the awakened power. I'm not very much like these words, but whatever. The post-sunflower, the power, then manifests in the mayor election at the end of the year. And the reason why is that the Nationalist Party was not responsive enough to this, the Kuomintang, the ex-dictatorship, was not responding to this enough because they were so tied with the mainstream media and so on, and the mainstream corporations. So so all the major cities except for one, Kuomintang lost the mayor election. And there's four mayors who were elected, not believing they were elected, actually. They expect to lose because they were trailing in the opinion polls. But the opinion polls, again, was too traditional because they were landline. Costs. They were not mobile phone costs. So all of them won by 5% or even 10% margin due to people who don't answer landline phones anymore, and so on. So then we everybody know then the Nationalist Party will lose everything in the next presidential election, which is this year, this January. And indeed they did. I mean, they are now 20% or so of parliament. They're over. Now, so the political system appears because the Taipei mayor, Ko Wen-je, an independent, not a politician, was a surgeon, was crowdsourcing his entire campaign using Sunflower technology and crowdfunding also the entire campaign and won by record numbers. And so all these movements makes the civil society believe that now the representatives are really just their entry into the system. And I mean, the same as the Podemos dynamics. And with the city level corporations like that, it then becomes possible to think on a national level, because everybody anticipates Tsai Ing-wen to win the presidential election. And once she wins the presidential election, we're now looking at the what I call the after party political system, because our current prime minister, Simon Zhang, who was a Google engineer, is not any party, does not belong to any party. And Tsai Ing-wen's next prime minister, Lin Quan, who will take office in May the 20s, has never belonged to any political party. And Tsai Ing-wen's vice president has never belonged to any party, and is a knight of the Vatican. And the Taipei City mayor, because all the previous president before Tsai was Taipei City mayors, also does not belong to any political party. So with this kind of diamond post-party top elected official status, they start to say previously unimaginable things, like the administration team would do the transition but not to another party. All the transition has to done with any data you require will first be made open data and then made available to you. And then, or all the transition discussions will be filmed and then made into public transcript for the world, and so on. So it's a very, not just post-party, but even post-nation kind of thinking that the Google person and the Vatican person specializing in public health is doing nowadays. So everybody sees that it's much more effective this way for the platform or for the program to be set in this kind of way instead of just wasting one bit of time in the party politics, because the Nationalist Party did that and they just imploded because of that. So it's a negative demo of the party, the remnant of the party system in Taiwan. So I guess that's the high-level power structure. So with this kind of climate, you could see how it's gives us a lot of room for experimentation.
I was wondering, because you started the presentation by saying that you looked a little bit at our tool in Data Lab, and if you had any reflections or idea of things we could push forward at our own scale.
Well, I mean, one thing is to introduce automatic Google translation on the blog. And it will make it easier for me. And well, jokes aside, I think your existing way of using really very much the same tools as the Sunflower technology, I mean, they are the best of breed tools nowadays, right? It's really on the same level or even better than us. I think the Gitbook, the way you use the Gitbook with the Frema soft issue tracking for the Open Government Partnership, is actually, I learned a lot from that particular formatting. I would say, though, that there is no single point of entry, because for the V-Taiwan, the Gitbook is single point of entry. And on the margin of Gitbook, we show the discourse, we show police, we show whatever other things. So you can see a very clear timeline. For example, this, which I promised to show. The Digital Convergence website. Yeah, this is very new. This starts on the second anniversary of Sunflower. But the idea is that the five laws of digital convergence are represented by five icons. So, for example, the whatever Telecommunication Act. So it shows right in the front that there is going to be a deliberation in April the 6th, and that the consultation period progress bar is like this. When you click into it, you see the Gitbook. And we use a Gitbook plugin that we wrote called the Gitbook Lexicon that defines all the different keywords that people may have different definition or like jargons. This is also supplied by the ministry. They have to translate maybe 10 words of legalese into 100 words of lay speak. But it avoids us having to expand in the Gibbo itself that was 100 words. So that's a very practical, technical thing, like explaining what is opt-out in advertisement and so on. And then the Gibbo then correlates to while people are really participating. It just went on a couple of days ago. Right, so then the discourse is shown here, and people are citing the issues of, what is this? The measurement of connection speed in the French metropolis. It is actually one of the report from France, saying that we should introduce a very similar system, and so on. And then the NCC replies, and this is again a difference in our way of using discourse, in that we have all the ministries, the National Communication Committee or the Ministry of Transport or whatever, have their own account on discourse. Mm-hmm. And all of them agreed when the facilitator tags them, mentions them, they must reply in 7 days. So there's no mediator here. And usually what happens in more ancient ministries like the Ministry of Health and Welfare is that they print this out and then attach it to a three-layer form, and then they sign their signature, and then one of the responsible people did a handwriting, and then the upper-level deputy minister did a signature of approval, and then some very unfortunate person has to untype those back to the discourse system. So the actual flow, which is the same flow as sending an email to the minister flow, is just public this time, right? But the flow usually takes 7 days because there's a lot of paper involved. But some of the ministries have a vice minister, deputy minister, who is very good with technology. And then we see 1 hour responses because he can approve his own. or maybe with Minister Jacqueline Tsai, she can even just have a Facebook chat with the person proposing the question. So it differs from the digital skill. 7 days is just a bare minimum. So then the dynamic is different, because then we are really just mediators. We translate the layperson questions into somewhat legalistic questions, and then translate back the ministry's responses into somewhat accessible responses. And that's really the only work we do. And we try to delineate the objective, reflective, and interpretational parts. And whenever people mention the French or the Japan example, the STLI, which is the Industry of Information Institute, the private sector people, because they specialize in this kind of law, they translate it in full to Chinese. So people can freely cite foreign documents and get the again translated within 7 days as part of their discussion. I think aside from troll management, which I see actually you're doing very well, this tagging system is, I think, the main difference. We use discourse compared to how you use discourse, and it's maybe something that's we could exchange from. That's it.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I have another question.
Yes.
On how we use discourse. We are trying to find a way to make consensus appear, or
mm-hmm.
or to have summaries, automatic summaries, because there's a long thread of discussions,
yeah.
But we don't see to pass a clear message to policymakers, like we need like a
yes.
compact.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You need a RFC, yes.
Do you know of any plugin
mm-hmm.
or any tools that we could use for that?
I wish. I mean, this is essentially asking how I come up with the ORID summary, right? No, this is wetware. we don't have software for it, I'm sorry. People expect they will see it by the end of consultation method. but it's actually me maybe drinking too much coffee and spending a day or two to read through everything and come up with something like this. But I think with this kind of waterfall presentation and the weight of the fonts, you can make most out of the limited cognitive bandwidth so that people really see their ideas being represented but without consuming too much space. So maybe one of the experiments I want to do also is that every week or every couple of weeks make a tentative summary of the discussion so far, instead of waiting until the last day and lose sleep because of it. But I mean, I work in computational linguistics, so I know it will be 2 or 3 years before we have reliable NL technology for this domain. But the more we use, the more we do this, the more information machines have. So then machine learning has more to learn from. So at some point they will take over, but then not this year.
And also, sorry, how did you make like the ministers agree to respond, reply?
In 7 days?
When
yeah. Time. Yeah. Oh yeah, that's a long story. sorry?
It took more than 7 days.
Yeah. Jesus, it's I don't know whether you do, but this is this course and it has a badge system. I don't know whether you use the badge system.
Yes.
You do. Okay.
These are discourse persons.
Okay, so this is the badge that says ministries, and it shows the logo of all the ministries, right? So it's a scoreboard, basically. We start with the ministry with the highest buy-in, like a Ministry of Finance, who really want to do this crowdfunding platform because it's so hip and cool thing, right? And then they are the person who I said reply within an hour because the deputy minister did it himself. So and then with just one or two demo ministries like this, we show all the ministries and then we show how frequent they reply to their reports, and then we see that, for example, the TFDA, the Food and Drug Agency, when they take more than 7 days to respond, the discussion quality becomes low. But then you can see that in the next room, the Ministry of Finance is doing very well and actually doing a lot of PR work because a reporter was trying to write something very negative about their efforts. But the reporter was also a VTaiwan participant, and so she did a fact checking. And then the deputy minister replied immediately saying, no, that's a rumor. Or it's actually written like this. And so a potential PR disaster was avoided. And so with things like that, it becomes easier for them to convince their peers that this bunch of people are really not against us. They're elevating our power as public servants, as professional public servants. And then they manage to convince more people. But still, we have people who take more than 7 days, and usually the reason was that it's them admitting a fault, like a system that they everybody thought they have built, but they have not actually built. So they have to get not only approval of the ministers, but also the office of PR, the office of media, and say it's okay to admit this mistake. But because the political atmosphere is that refusing to reply becomes a even more shameful thing than admitting that you have weaknesses or faults, eventually they still did reply, and then we hug the trolls. I mean, we treat them not as disruptors, but as opportunities for the civil society to build partnership with. So after a few times of them seeing that this is not like the public media where they get flamed for admitting their mistakes. Instead, they get volunteers, they get support. It becomes much easier after that. But it took, as you said, more than 7 days. It took 7 months, I think, for all the ministries to see this dynamic. Yeah. We're good?
I think we are good. Well, thank you so much
okay.
From all the team.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Congratulations. Well, there's a long way to go about the airport case, ecology cases also. Is everybody okay if I upload what I did and the recording on YouTube? Is there anyone who wants to censor their own speech?